Skyboat Media presents Glimpses, written by Lewis Shiner, narrated by Stefan Rudnicki. Chapter 1. Get Back. Once upon a time, there was going to be a Beatles album called Get Back. They tried to record it in January of 1969, first at Twickenham Film Studios, then in the basement of Apple Corps at 3 Savile Row. Their own overpriced 24-track Dream Studio wasn't finished, and they had to bring in a mobile unit. So there they were, under bright lights, using rented gear, with cameras filming every move they made. Paul had this idea he could turn things around. He wanted to get back to the kind of material the band did in 61 and 62 at the Kaiserkeller in Hamburg and the Cavern Club in Liverpool. It must have seemed like another century to them, looking back. They tried to warm up with Chuck Berry standards and One After 909, something of John's from when he was 17. But it was winter and snowy and cold. The soundstage echoed and the basement was cramped. It just wasn't happening. That summer they would try again, and this time it would work, and they would come away with Abbey Road. The tapes from the other sessions would end up with Phil Spector, who would overproduce the living Jesus out of them to make them sound alive, and finally they would come out as Let It Be. The new title pretty much says it all. Between winter and summer, everything changed. Paul married Linda, John married Yoko, and Alan Klein took over Apple. By then it was too late to get back, ever again. My father died not quite 2 weeks ago. I can say the words, but they don't seem to mean anything or even matter much. My mind goes blank, so I think about other things. I put Let It Be on the stereo and wonder what it would sound like if things had been different. Music is easy. It isn't even that important what the words say. The real meaning is in the guitars and drums, the way a record sounds. It's a feeling that's bigger than words could ever be. A guy named Paul Williams said that, or something close to it, and I believe it's true. I've been in Dallas with my mother, straightening out the VA insurance, helping her write a form letter to use instead of a Christmas card, answering the phone, getting Dad's name off the bank account. A million little things that can bleed you dry. Now I'm home again in Austin trying to make sense of it. It's November of 1988. The old man died the week before Thanksgiving. A hell of a thing. He was scuba diving in Cozumel, which he was too old for, with my mother along for the ride. He used to teach anthropology at SMU, but since he retired, all he wanted to do was dive. My wife and I flew up to Dallas to meet my mother's plane as she came back alone, looking about 100 years old. She'd had him burned down there in Mexico, brought a handful of ashes with her in a Ziploc bag. Elizabeth came home that weekend, and I stayed up there 10 days, all I could stand. Then I drove back here in his white GMC pickup truck, my inheritance. The inside still smells like him, sweat and polyester and old Fritos. Anyway, it's 1988, and it was just last year that they finally released all the Beatles albums on CD, making a big deal of how it was the 20th anniversary of Sgt. Pepper. It was like everybody had forgotten about the 60s until we had this nationwide fit of nostalgia. Suddenly, every station on the radio has gone to some kind of oldies format, and they play the same stuff over and over again that you haven't heard in 20 years, and now you're sick to death of Spirit in the Sky and the Year 2525 all over again. Tie-dyed shirts are back, and bands that should never have been together in the first place have reunion tours, and everybody shakes their heads over how dumb and idealistic they used to be. I run a stereo repair business out of the house. Most of the upstairs is my shop. The north wall is my workbench, covered with tools, an oscilloscope, and a digital multimeter, a couple of my clients' boxes with their insides spread out. The wall above it is cork, and there are a million pieces of junk pinned to it. Circuit diagrams, pictures of me and Elizabeth and the cat, phone messages, business cards from my parts people, a big black and white poster of Jimi Hendrix that I've had since college. The west wall is windows, partly covered by corn plants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.